Let's pray. Thank you for just the chance to gather as your people and to sing your praises and to hear from your word. And we just ask that you would just change us this morning, just allow your spirit to change our hearts and for us to be able to accept anything that you put on us. And we just thank you for everything that you do for us, all of the many blessings that we are so undeserving of, and especially for the one of your son. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will.
On bended knee I come. With a humble heart I come, bowing down before your holy throne, lifting holy hands to you as I pledge my love anew. I worship you in spirit. I worship you in truth. Make my life a holy praise unto you. On bended knee I come with a broken heart I come, bowing down before your holy throne. As I look upon your face, show your mercy and your grace. Change my life, O Holy Spirit. Make me fresh and ever new. Make my life a holy sacrifice to you. Come to the table of mercy. Prepare with the wine and the bread. All who are hungry and thirsty, come and your souls will be fed. Come at the Lord's invitation. Receive from his nail-scarred hand. Bread of salvation and drink of the blood of the Lamb. Why don't you come at the Lord's invitation? Receive from his nail-scarred hand. Eat of the bread of salvation and drink of the blood of the Lamb.
I hope you'll be patient with me this morning. I have a number of scriptures that I would like to read in an attempt to remind us of our relationship with God. We are forgetful people. We forget our vows that we make towards each other. We forget our vows that we make towards God. And the first scripture that I'm going to read is interesting, that God needs a reminder to remember the covenant that he made with us. Fellow believers, let us find encouragement in remembering. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, I now establish my covenant with you, and with your descendants after you, and with every living creature that was with you, the birds, the livestock, and all the wild animals, all those that came out of the ark with you, every living creature on earth. I establish my covenant with you. Never again will all life be destroyed by the waters of a flood. Never again will there be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, this is the sign of the covenant I am making between me and you and every living creature with you, a covenant for all generations to come. I have set my rainbow in the clouds, and it will be the sign of the covenant between me and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will remember my covenant between me and you and all living creatures of every kind. Never again will the waters become a flood to destroy all earth. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. When the Lord your God brings you into the land he swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, to give you, a land with large, flourishing cities you did not build, houses filled with all kinds of good things you did not provide, wells you did not dig, and vineyards and olive groves you did not plant. Then when you eat and are satisfied, be careful that you do not forget the Lord, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. Remember, remember, remember. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good land he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large and your silver and gold increase and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, my power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me. But remember the Lord your God, for it is he who gives you the ability to produce wealth and so confirms his covenant, which he swore to your ancestors as it is today. Jesus asked them, why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember? When I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? 12, they replied. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election, for if you do these things, you will never stumble, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So I will always remind you of these things, even though you know them and are firmly established in the truth you now have. I think it is right to refresh your memory. As long as I live in the tent of this body, because I know that I will soon put it aside as our Lord Jesus Christ has made clear to me. And I will make every effort to see that after my departure, you will always be able to remember these things. But dear friends, remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ foretold. They said to you, in the last times there will be scoffers who follow their own ungodly desires. These are the people who divide you, who follow mere natural instincts and do not have the Spirit. But you, dear friends, by building yourselves up in your most holy faith and praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you to eternal life. Be merciful to those who doubt. Save others by snatching them from the fire. To others show mercy mixed with fear. To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up. Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief. And you will not know at what time I will come to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for being able to gather together as a group of believers this morning to encourage each other. And we know that we are forgetful people, and we do need a lot of reminders of who you are and to remember the promises that you have given us and to continually seek you. And we do thank you for this memorial, this supper that we're about to have, and the remembrance that we have of Christ, and that he gave his body for us, that we would be forgiven, and help us to walk in that way and to know that we are forgiven and to see Jesus in our daily lives and to continue church even beyond this place. And we just pray that you would be with us as we take the bread and help us to remember your son and his body. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just as I am without one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to I come.
Heavenly Father, in the middle of all the distractions that we have and all of the physical blessings that we have, may we remember that these blessings are not from anything that we have done, and may they not be a distraction. And may we not feel entitled. Help us with our attitudes and our patience and our lack of self-control. And we thank you for your Son and for the reminder of the gift that he gave, for the strength that we have from the time that we have with you, especially for this time. We remember that he gave his body for us, and that we are forgiven, and that we have salvation, and that there's more to come, and there's better things to come besides the things that we have here. And just pray for this juice that we'll take. May we be reminded of the blood that he shed for us, that we are forgiven and made free. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul of one dark blot, to thee whose blood can cleanse each spot, O Lamb of God, I come. just as I am.
Let's stand one more for one more song before Jody brings us our lesson this morning.
Your light broke through my night, restored exceeding joy. Your grace fell like the rain and made this desert live. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. Stand on higher ground. Your praise rose in my heart and made this valley sing. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have turned my sorrow into joy. You have turned sorrow into this. Is how we overcome. This is how we overcome.
Yeah, I love that. Be seated, please. Be seated. Thank you. Thanks, guys. That's one of those young people songs, right? It's all right. Hey, look in 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter, it may be easier just to go to the back of the Bible. Last book of the Bible is Concordance, okay? And then, or maps, and then back up to 1 Peter chapter 1 is where we'll be. So, hey in the balcony. Y'all all right? Good. Hello online. Y'all all right? Good. 1 Peter chapter 1. Brad, thank you. Isn't it awesome that we've got a deep bench? He's doing a great job this morning in Lincoln's absence. So, if you harbor some not so positive feelings about religion or religious people because you feel we've been a little too judgy or intolerant or preoccupied with moral issues, the passage that we're going to look at today could turn you off pretty quickly. And if you're fine with the whole Bible, Jesus, church thing, but you're really sensitive, you're a Christian who's really sensitive to the fact that some folks are disposed to think of Christians as uninformed or closed-minded or hopelessly out of touch, then some of the passage that we're going to look at today, some of the words in this passage are going to give you heartburn. See, if you were to close your eyes and I read this passage in the right voice, You could imagine yourself sitting in a revival tent somewhere in South Georgia, waving a funeral home fan to shoo away the awful heat and flies the size of grapes, because that's how big we grow them down there. And you'd be listening to a sweaty Southern evangelist in a white suit preach a hellfire and damnation sermon. That's what you would think if I read this passage the right way. In just 9 verses, the word obedience comes up twice. The word holy or derivatives of the word holy come up 6 times. Peter brings up the second coming. He mentions judgment day, which is always a winsome subject. And he just goes off on evil desires. He talks a lot about purity and reverence and the fear of God. The only thing that's really missing from this passage is a box of snakes for us to take out and handle, which we are not going to do. So before we read the words, it's a good idea to remember something about the man who wrote them. Peter was one of Jesus' original 12 apostles, men who were specifically called and commissioned to take his message to the world. Most of the time, and some of you are already thinking about this, most of the time when people think of Peter, they think of someone who was constantly having to pull his foot out of his mouth. The reason people think about Peter that way is because he was someone who had to constantly be pulling his foot out of his mouth. Peter always had to say something, whether he had something to say or not. He was just as impetuous in his behavior as he was in his language. You really get the impression that there were times when Jesus looked at Peter's brother, Andrew, and just did this. And Andrew said, "I got nothing. I don't know." If you could look at a Myers-Briggs personality profile, Peter would be something like ENFJ, intuitive, inspiring, dedicated, but tends to be self-critical and controlling. Or if he did that animal personality profile, like all down those at work, he'd be the otter. His color would be blue. But besides his really strong and sometimes quirky personality, Peter knew what it was to fail. In Jesus' darkest hour, Peter denied that he even knew him, denied it 3 times, and that nearly killed him. In fact, I'm pretty certain that he never forgot how awful it felt to let Jesus down. They say that Peter died by crucifixion. Tradition says that he died by crucifixion, except when they came to take him to his cross, he requested to be crucified upside down. We don't know if this is true or not, but that's the story, that he requested to be crucified upside down because he didn't deem himself worthy to die like Jesus. So what we're going to read here is going to come across a little hard to some of us. But you got to remember, it's coming from a guy who once found himself surrounded by people who did not share his views or his beliefs, and a guy who failed under that pressure. He is writing to people who are themselves under pressure to compromise their beliefs and cave in to their culture. He's writing to exiles. And he remembers how awful failure feels and how close he came to losing his faith forever. So if it seems like he's getting up in our business a little bit, maybe we can cut him some slack and give him a hearing, because I think he earned it based on his recovery from failure. So we're going to read 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning in verse 13, and we'll read down to verse 21, okay? Here we go, 1 Peter 1, 13. "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance," which sounds a lot like that passage from Romans chapter 12 we heard a little bit earlier. "But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.' Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear, for you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him you believe in God, who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. Let's have a prayer, and then we're going to dig into this passage a little bit. Father, bless us as we hear this word. Help us as we think about it. Bless us with insight to take these words and put them into our lives starting today. Help us to live as exiles in a culture that doesn't live like Jesus. In his name we pray, amen. Peter starts this passage with the word therefore, which means that what he's about to say is predicated on what he has just said, which we talked about last week. The first 12 verses in this letter are all about identity, who you are. When you are living as an exile, remembering who you are, remembering your identity is absolutely critical. And I think we get that. I mean, we just intuitively know that when you are not around people like you, remembering who you are is critical. Lisa had a real funny experience this past week driving back from, she'd been over to Atlanta last week for a shower for our daughter-in-law's about to have a baby. Actually, our daughter-in-law's about to have our grandbaby. That's how that works. So Lisa was coming back from the shower, and she was on 431 coming up from Gunnersville. And this lady in another car pulled up beside her. Lisa was driving my car, okay? She's in my car, which has the Georgia Bulldogs tag frame around the tag, right? So, which is identity. So this woman pulls up beside Lisa and starts blowing her horn and waving and smiling. And Lisa looked over there, and every time we see somebody in a grocery store who's friendly, we think they're one of you, okay? They may not be, but we greet them that way because you never know. We still haven't learned everybody yet. So this woman pulls up beside Lisa, and she's blowing and waving, and Lisa's going, I have no idea who you are, you know, waving. And then the woman holds up a Georgia Bulldogs pillow and is smiling. And I'm so proud of my wife, who's not a Georgia Bulldog fan. But it's hard to explain going 80 miles an hour up 431 what you are and what you're not. So Lisa just said, go dogs. That sweet lady drove off feeling a little bit less alone in Philistine territory. That's all I'm saying. So we get the idea, right? That remembering who you are is really, really important. Peter told them in the passage we looked at last week, the first 12 verses, that you're the elect. God voted for you. You're chosen by God. Peter said you've been given new birth. You've got living hope. You've got purpose in suffering. The salvation that you enjoy, the prophets and the angels are envious to look into what the thing that you have. That's who you are. Based on that, he's going to talk about how we live. Now, he does this a couple of times in the book of 1 Peter. He'll spend some time going, here's who you are. Now, here's how that impacts what you do Monday to Friday. Here's who you are. Here's how you live. Okay, we're in one of the how you live sections right now. So how do exiled people who have new birth, living hope, purpose and suffering, and enviable salvation, how do we live? First thing Peter says is basically, this is not going to be easy. Verse 13, you're going to need minds that are alert and fully sober. Technically, that's an accurate translation, but it's so academic and passionless, it doesn't even come close to capturing Peter's meaning. I like the old translations better here. The literal phrase is, gird up the loins of your mind, which explains why they translated it as alert and fully sober, because nobody knows what gird up the loins of your mind mean. Back then, everybody wore robes. And if you needed to run or fight or work, you would tuck the robes into a belt, into a girdle, so that you could move about with more freedom. Today, we'd say something like, roll up your sleeves. That's how we'd put it today. Roll up the sleeves of your mind. Living as a cultural exile is going to be challenging for you. It is going to require mental toughness. It is going to be hard work. So Peter's being real honest with us. You can trust the Bible. It is always going to be real honest with you. You may not like what it says. You may not like how it says it. It may make you really uncomfortable. It may not be politically correct, but it's going to be the truth. And so the truth is, living like a Christian in a culture that doesn't live like Christ, living like an exile is going to be hard mental work. Plus, Peter is reminding us where the real battle is. It's in our minds. It's how we think. It's the things we believe to be true. It's the narratives we embrace. That's where the struggle is. And then he adds some reassurance. First he says, this is going to be hard. So roll up the sleeves of your mind. Roll up your mental sleeves. But then he says, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. We talked about hope a little bit last week, but now Peter puts a finer point on it. The hope that we have is centered on the grace we will receive when Jesus returns. Yes, being a Christian, living like a cultural exile, is hard work, but you are doing this in a context of grace. I love that song that we sang during the communion, during the Lord's Supper. Just as I am, I come broken, I come needy. We are living our Christian lives. We are living as exiles in a context of grace. Martin Luther King Jr. said, the moral arc of the universe bends towards justice. He's right. But if you're one of God's people, the arc of justice is bordered by grace. We don't earn God's favor. We don't win God's favor. We don't buy God's favor. We receive it as a gift. So here's what Peter's saying. This is going to be a real challenge. But you have the assurance of God's grace. And then Peter says, now here's how you do it. Here's how you live. I think there are two principles in these verses that can help us live like exiles. The first one is in verses 14 and 15. As obedient children, which is a reminder of our identity. Do you see him doing that? As obedient children, you're children of God. God's your father. God loves you. God gave you new birth. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who called you is holy, so you be holy in all that you do, because it is written, be holy because I am holy. Okay, here's the principle. Principle number one, to live as a cultural exile, you have to practice holy nonconformity. Do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. I like it that Peter mentions evil desires here. That reminds us, that we are not at war with people. We are at war with ideas, which is exactly what Peter says in chapter 2, verse 11. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 11. It may be just across the page, depending on how your Bible is arranged, but he says, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. You and I are not in a war with people. We talk about the culture wars, and I don't mind that language. I really don't, because I think in a lot of ways that's what's going on here. There's a battle going on in our culture. What we've got to remember is that the battle is not with people. The battle is with ideas, with concepts. And so it's really, I think it's important that Peter reminds us of that. I like it that he says, do not conform. Here's a truth that we need to accept, we need to embrace, we need to embody. All right, and it's going to sound like it's for you guys, but it's for everybody, okay? Here it is. Christianity is never going to be cool. It is never. If you're a Christian, you can give up. Just let go of the idea of being whatever cool is, whatever the in thing is, whatever is hip or hot or whatever word we're using these days for it. If you're a Christian, it's just not going to happen for you. Because Christianity is, by its very nature, a non-conformist way of life. There will always be tension between Christian values and cultural values. It doesn't matter how young or old you are, if you are a Christian, there will always, 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 there's always going to be some strangeness about you. We spent some time last week talking about how supportive of Christian values the culture used to be. But even then, being a Christian wasn't cool. Because while the culture supported many of our moral values, many of the moral values found in the Bible, it was deeply antagonistic to the justice values in God's Word. If you were a Christian in the 1950s, and you took a stand against racism and discrimination, that was an anti-cultural stand. You were at odds with the culture. You were not cool. Nowadays, you can be all about justice. You can be all about equality, and the culture is going to think you're awesome. But if you take a stand on the sanctity of traditional marriage, one man married to one woman for life, or if you take a stand on the rights of the unborn to live, you're at odds with the culture. You're a hater, is what they'll say about you. One way or another, if you take your identity as a Christian seriously, you are going to be a nonconformist. In verse 15, he tells us why. Just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am. He's quoting Leviticus chapter 19. The ancient rabbis used to say that Leviticus chapter 19, I think it's around verse 1 or 2, used to say that was the summation of the Mosaic law. Be holy because I am holy. That's what the whole book of Leviticus is about. I can save you some time. You need to read it, but the whole book of Leviticus is all about one thing, holiness, being holy. That passage is right in the middle, that be holy because I'm holy, that's right in the middle of the Mosaic law, the middle book and the middle part of the middle book. But the idea of holiness is about as familiar to us as the phrase, gird up your loins. So when the Bible talks about God being holy, when it says God is holy, it's referring to God's awesomeness, God's power, God's majesty, God's distinctiveness, God's separateness. And I'm going to use a dirty word here, okay? I'm going to use a dirty word in church. He's talking about God's intolerance of evil, of things that are impure, unclean, polluted, profane. Back in the Bible days, people thought of holiness as a kind of current that ran through the world, like a force. Like the Force in Star Wars or something, or like electricity. Peter kind of demystifies the concept of holiness, which is one of the things I love about Peter. He's a great theologian. He really is. He does a lot of good theology here, but, you know, Paul is always kind of like out there. Peter even says in his second letter, some of the things Paul writes are hard to understand, which I love about Peter. Right? But he's really down to earth. He's a good theologian, but he's really down to earth. So Peter demystifies the concept of holiness. He says, be holy in all you do, in your doing. The word for do there is conduct. That particular word shows up 13 times in the New Testament, and 6 of them are in 1 Peter. I think what he's trying to say is this: holiness isn't just some abstract quality. It's not some intangible concept. It's not about adopting some super religious tone. Holiness is what you do. It's how you live. God has elected you. God has chosen you. God has made you holy. So you get out there and do holiness. Let me give you a couple of questions to ask to flesh this idea out a little bit. A couple of questions. Am I doing the basics? Am I doing the basics? Leviticus chapter 19, where this idea of holiness comes up the first time, when God tells Israel to be holy, he includes things like respect your parents, tell the truth, don't steal from other people, take care of the poor, love other people. In that Leviticus 19 passage, when God's talking about holiness, he tells farmers, don't glean the edges of your field, the corners. Don't glean the corners, and don't go back over a field you just harvested a second time. You know why I said that? Because that's where the poor would go. The poor would go to a field that had been harvested, and they'd go over it and find things that the original harvesters left behind. The poor would go in and glean the corners of the fields that the farmer had left behind. That's holiness. Holiness is doing the basics. Are you doing the basics? Am I doing the basics? Here's the second question. Am I doing what everybody else does? See, the answer to the first question is, am I doing the basics? If you want trying to be holy, it needs to be yes, I'm doing the basics. But the second question, am I doing what everybody else does? That answer needs to be no. Look, sometimes doing what everybody else does is good and right and wise. For example, driving on the right side of the road, that's a good thing. If you're doing that, keep doing it. If you're not going to do that, take your Twickenham Church of Christ bumper sticker off your car. Get a Whitesburg Baptist bumper sticker, all right? Sometimes doing what everybody else does is good. But sometimes doing what everybody else does just means that you've caved in on some of your principles. Okay, so what movies are you going to see? What movies are you renting on Netflix? What are you watching online? Which websites are you visiting? What are you reading? What books are you reading? So there's some books that we really don't have any business reading. There just are. There's nothing artistically valuable or culturally enlightening about them. And we know what they are. You don't even have to, I wonder what would be a good criteria. You know garbage when you read the title sometimes. How are you using your resources? If your life and my life, our lives as Christians, are no different than anybody else's, we are no longer living in exile. We've become citizens of the culture. We got our cards. We belong. So we have to think critically. We have to roll up the sleeves of our minds and be honest with ourselves, and practice holy non-conformity. That's principle number one. Here's principle number two. To live as a cultural exile, you need to remember the end and the beginning. Verse 17 offers a motive for doing holiness. You call on a father who judges. Okay, can we just stop on that word right there? Because I used one dirty word earlier, intolerance. Here's another dirty word, judges. As in passing judgment. And Peter's really clear here. I mean, he's not hiding anything. He says it. You call on a father who judges. Each person's work impartially. Without, the Greek word means without regard to your face. We used to talk about judgment all the time. We used to talk about Judgment Day all the time. We don't talk about it much anymore. Do you know why we don't talk about it much anymore? Because we used to talk about it all the time. That's kind of what we do is we go back and forth. Peter is not afraid to bring it up here. He mentions it again in chapter 4, verse 17. He says, it is time for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will the outcome be for those who don't obey the gospel of Christ? And then he really turns the heat up in his second letter, in chapter 3, verse 10. Now you can really hear that white-suited, sweaty Southern evangelist, but the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. The elements will be destroyed by fire. The earth and everything in it will be laid bare, since everything will be destroyed in this way. What kind of people ought you to be? You ought to live holy and godly lives. We just should quit right there. Won't you please come while together we stand and sing, right? That's some powerful stuff. I know that talking about judgment is not what cool Christians like to talk about. But we've been over this. You cannot be cool and be a Christian. Judgment is a real thing. It is going to happen. We need to remember that. It is not hateful to tell people the truth that that's coming. I don't think you ought to lead with it. I don't think we ought to talk about it every single week, but we can't act like it's not a reality, it's not a thing in Scripture, and it's not a real thing. We got to tell folks. Judgment is a real thing. It's really going to happen. We got to remember that. And even if it doesn't happen in your lifetime or mine, and it may not, Peter reminds us in verse 24 that people are like grass. We're going to either see Jesus return in our lifetime, and I'll remind you that he'll be bringing grace with him when he comes. That's what he says in this very first verse here that we began looking at, verse 13. We're either going to see him return in our lifetime, or we're going to grow old, we're going to wither, we're going to die like the flowers of the field. Either way, we're only here for a little while, and we will be held accountable. Some of us need to really think about that, because we know how we're living right now does not match who we are. Some of us really need to think about judgment, because we are not living in holy nonconformity. But Peter doesn't just want you to look at the future. He wants you to look back to, that's verses 18 and 19. Because you know, he says, that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down by your ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. That would have really resonated with some of Peter's readers, because many of them had been brought to this central part of Turkey as slaves, as prisoners of war. They may have been prisoners of war. They may have been victims of kidnapping, or what we would now call human trafficking. Some of them perhaps have been able to find or earn the money to buy their freedom. Others, as we'll see later on in the book, still lived as somebody else's property. He is writing to people who lived as somebody else's property. But at least in one way, they were not slaves any longer. He says, you've been redeemed. You've been bought out of slavery to sin by the blood of Jesus. Peter pointed them back to that event. He wanted them to remember the cross of Jesus and the day they put their hope in that cross. Remembering was one of the most powerful ways they had of living like cultural exiles. Let me give you two quick questions to help you work this principle into your life. If I knew Jesus was coming back tomorrow, what decisions would I make today? If I knew he was coming back tomorrow, what decisions would I make today? I'm not talking about your 401k. I'm talking about lifestyle decisions. Those that have to do with how you live and what values you embody. And maybe I'm talking about that decision about your relationship with God, the one that you've been putting off. If I knew he was coming back tomorrow, what decision would I make today? Second question, if I knew that Jesus thought specifically and personally of me when he died on the cross, how would I think and act differently today? See, one of those questions looks ahead, just like Peter does here. One of those looks back. If I knew he thought about me personally, how would I think and act? Because I think that's what he did. I think that's what he did. He thought about you personally when he died. Thinking about the future, thinking about judgment will motivate some of us. But thinking about somebody who was willing to sacrifice himself in order to redeem us, to buy us out of an empty way of life, can motivate all of us to live lives of holy nonconformity. We're going to have a prayer here, and at the end of the prayer, we're going to sing. We'll stand. And if you want to come for prayer this morning, down front, we'll pray with you. If you want to come down to rededicate your life to living like an exile, living in nonconformity, you said you want to say, hey, I'm not sure I've been doing that. I want to rededicate myself to that, and I want y'all to hold me accountable. I'm telling everybody that's what I want to do. If you want to come say that, we'll pray with you. If you want to give your life to Christ in baptism this morning, if that's a decision you know you need to make, but you've been putting it off, you know what to do, you know what it means, but you've been putting it off, and you're ready to do that this morning, and we'll stop everything to help you do that, okay? Let's stand up and have a prayer, then we'll sing. Lord, we pray a blessing on the hearing of your word today. I pray that the things I've said about it are accurate and true, and I pray that all of the thoughts that we've had will work together to help us to live in holy nonconformity this week. Bless those in the room this morning who need to make a decision. If it's a public one, give them the courage to make it. If they need to make a decision privately, just between them and you, give them the faith to make that decision and the freedom to share that with somebody else, whether it's a bunch of people or just one special person they trust. Bless us as we try to live as holy nonconformists this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You come if you need to. Let's sing.
Refiner's fire, my heart's one desire is to be holy, set apart for you, Lord. I choose to be holy, set
shower today. It was going to be a couple weeks ago, but Axel decided he would show up early. So Jay and Hildy, a shower today, 1:30 rather, in the Mercy Building. They are registered at Target and Babies R Us. Outback America is coming up. That's a wonderful relationship building event. It's less than 3 weeks away. You can find out about it at outback.org online. For more information, you could contact Todd or Lori Beth White. They will be in New York for a while yet. You can contact me, and I can tell you all about it. My name's Walton, by the way. Don't hesitate. It's a wonderful event, and I'd be happy to share with you what that's all about. The fall small groups have been formed, and those directories are available in the lobbies or online at twickenham.org. If you have questions, please contact Steve Krieger. The spring. Our instrumental worship is next week at 5 o'clock. I think it's going to be up here. If you have never been, I encourage you to come. I can guarantee you will be blessed. I can also guarantee you that you will not be the oldest nor the youngest one there. So you'll fit right in. It is a wonderful opportunity. It'll be next week at 5 o'clock. Wedding shower on the 13th, next week on Sunday. For Caitlin McKee and George Hill. That'll be next week. They are registered at Target and Bed Bath and Beyond. Other announcements and details in your bulletin. At this point, we'll have our closing prayer. I'm so thankful to see you all here. I hope you've been blessed. Again, if you've been visiting, if you visited with us, linger a moment if we haven't had a chance to greet you, and we would love to get to know you better. Daniel.
Let's pray. Lord, we are thankful that we are exiles. We are thankful that we are your children and we are called to live holy lives, Lord, but we know that is a challenge because of our sinful nature. We pray for courage and strength, judgment as we go about our everyday life, Lord. Help us to remember who we belong to, who we are, and never forget that. Thank you for the message from that Jody brought, and it was a great reminder of while we live in the world, until we can be home with you, we are called to separate ourselves and to live this holy life. And also, it's a good reminder who our identity is, and we are so grateful that we are your children. Thank you for that. Bless us this week, Father. Help us to be light in the world and that people will see us differently and want to know about that, and help us to share why we have hope and why we are different. And thank you for your son's sacrifice on the cross and what he did for us on that day. And it's in his name we pray. Amen.